ankles break. Whoa. I know you wish, I know you wish I would fade away, but I got more to say. Lord, they pray.
Alright, I'm a little dark, Let me get a little light right here. Come on, y'all, work with me. And my dog right here. Okay, I gotta move the whole set around. Boom. There we go. Pay attention. Pay attention. Come on, y'all. Y'all say pay attention. Come on. Can somebody say pay attention this morning? First and foremost, grand rising, everybody. I'm actually out here on the West Coast. It is actually 6:10 in the morning. I'm going to turn these comments off, okay? It's actually 6:10 in the morning. Over here on the West Coast, many of you all know that I've been doing this call. Actually, this call, Wake Up and Win call, started back in 2011 when I woke up one morning and I realized that every day that I wake up, I've been feeling like I'm on the wrong side of the bed. So many of you all may not know this, okay? But this call started in 2011 for me. I started this call when I was in a very, very, very dark place, and I woke up and I finally came to the realization that every day that I wake up cannot be a rainy day. You ever find yourself in a place where you start to notice that things don't feel right? You start to notice that you don't need to make sure I got my hotel name on the damn computer, or I mean TV, okay? Y'all be knocking on the door. So yeah, you ever realize, get into a place that you start to realize and feel that something is not right. Kind of like we talk about your intuition, you talk about your discernment, and you just feel like something is not right. And so for me, back in 2011, every day was not me waking up on the wrong side of the bed. And so finally I woke up one day, and it was 3.5 years had caught up with me, and I really realized that something wasn't right. And so when I got to that place, I started to look at myself. You know how most people are not mature enough to stop and recognize the role that they are playing in the position that they're in. So when I realized that it can't be that every day I'm waking up on the wrong side of the bed, and I started to look introspect, I started to realize that I had put myself in a place that I had to figure out how to get myself out of. You know, last week we talked about the Serenity Prayer and how the Serenity Prayer changed my life. You know, the Serenity Prayer, you guys know, God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things that I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Well, last week, when we talked about that, I didn't share this part of the story with you guys, but it's so funny how we all have versions of our stories that we decide to tell depending on how we feel at the moment or depending on the audience. And so yesterday I was so blessed to speak in front of thousands of people for the Margie Harvey Foundation, Steve Harvey wife, their foundation. And every year I'm invited back. I feel very grateful. Every year I'm invited back. Sometimes I wonder Like, why am I invited back? There's so many other people that are quote unquote professional speakers. There's so many people who quote unquote qualify to speak. Why is it that every year they call me back when Steve Harvey can get anybody? They 1 year they had Ayanna Von Zant, you know, come and speak. But I noticed year after year after year, Ayanna Von Zant is not being called. The big brands and the big names are not being called. But every year, my third year, I'm the one called. And yesterday, I was sitting at a home over 10,000 square feet in the mountains. I'm talking about basketball court. I'm talking about like a koi fish pond. You know, I'm talking about there's a part of the home that the doors retract and open up, and it's like you done took the whole wall out. You talking about a house that has a big old pool, and you talking about all the custom finishes because this home belongs to a person that is in business. And as I was sitting there yesterday, surrounded by more millionaires than I've ever been surrounded by in my life. Let me repeat that. I'm sitting in this room, and you know, sometimes, you know, you don't really realize how blessed you are, or you don't really realize what you're experiencing. And that's unfortunate because, you know, as you're on this journey, and we talked about this a couple weeks back, you know, the destination, you think that that's the goal. But when you really get to the destination, and I know that there's a lot of successful people on this call. I want to say shouts out to everyone that's with me here in Las Vegas. You know, shouts out to my brother, my friend, Chris Brown, somebody who has a story as well, who could have decided to give up. But no, he kept going. Shouts out to Chris. Shouts out to Natalie Nicole Smith, another young lady who is my sister, my friend. You're talking about yesterday, I had such a gratitude moment, so many moments, as I kept looking around at how many melanated people who were told they wasn't going to amount to nothing, who could have easily, you know, fell prey to selling drugs and ended up in jail. You know, I was surrounded by people who could have been those people who decided to be that baby mama or that girl who, you know, depends on a man to do something for her. And as I sat there, all I could think about was everybody's journey before they got to the place that they was in a home of a gentleman like Eric Worre's home. And you guys may not know Eric Worre. I know that there's a lot of you all on here that are network marketers. And there's a lot of you guys on here that every Monday, I just attract you because of my, I don't know, the message that I give and the way I give it so real. You know, I don't sugarcoat. I don't marinate nothing down. I give it to you, you know, how they say straight, no chaser. And I'm sitting there, guys, and I'm looking around and I look at Natalie and I'm thinking about, here's a girl who I met 5 years ago, okay? Here's a girl who I met 5 years ago. She was a hairstylist. She was that girl that you know how you look good, and when you look good, it ain't hard to get a man to do something for you. She could have been that girl that decided that that was enough because she had various men that was willing to take care of her. But let me tell y'all something. When you get to a place within your body that you realize that you deserve the absolute best, when you get to a place that you start to recognize that in order for the people around you to elevate, somebody is gonna have to be that person that makes that elevation. When you really get to that place, I think the whole world changes for you. And so as I'm sitting at Eric Worre's house, I look again and then I got, you know, Rodney here. And here's somebody who was in the streets heavy, doing this thing now in this house, you know, getting to understand more about the profession and the industry of network marketing. And all I could think about, guys, is what if I would have quit? What if back in 2011, when I woke up every day and I knew something wasn't right, what if I didn't take the time to, you know, instead of saying that, okay, maybe there's something going on with, you know, my husband, and the reason why I don't feel the way I need to feel every day is because I'm taking on his stress. You know, what if I just decided to say, oh, it's because I dropped out of school, you know, in the ninth grade, and I only have my GED for education. And now, you know, that's catching up with me. What if I would have said that, you know, I have a mom who sold drugs and a dad that sold drugs, and all I ever saw was drugs being sold. And so, you know, I got to live, you know, based upon what my mom and my dad did. You know, what if I would have stopped and said, man, my brother, who was my number one inspiration and motivation, what if I would have stopped at looking at my brother and saying, my brother sells drugs. And I looked up, and many of you, I may not know this, but I have a brother that did 13 years in prison for a crime that he did not commit. He gave away 13 years of his life, okay, and spent time in prison. 13 years, this one bid he did for a crime he did not commit. And I could remember my childhood years. I spent a lot of my childhood years, you know, going to the prisons with my mom and with my dad, because my mom and my dad, well, my dad actually made sure that we visited my brother every week. Many of y'all don't know this because I have two dads, right? I have two dads. And one of my dads, you know, is my biological father, okay? And then my light-skinned father, I call him light-skinned. My light-skinned father is really my brother's biological father. And my light-skinned father and I were very close growing up. He's the one that I lived in a house with. He's the one who taught me how to drive a car. I remember being, you know, like 10 years old, and he'll sit me on his lap, and we'll be driving around, and he'll teach me how to drive. And I remember in those moments, not really appreciating and understanding and recognizing what he was doing. But guys, when I looked up and I was in that room, all I could think about is when I saw my mom for the first time after I was living with my dad. You know, some of you all could recognize and remember being a stepchild. Do we have any stepchildren on the line this morning? Anybody who lived with a stepmom or lived with a stepdad? Or we have anybody that was in foster care? If you was in foster care or lived with a stepmom or stepdad, go ahead and drop a one right here in this chat real quick. I want to see something. If you are a stepchild and you remember living with your stepmom or your stepdad, or, you know, living with your mom boyfriend or living with your dad girlfriend, how many of y'all can remember that? Drop a one if you can remember that. Well, I was sharing with a friend of mine yesterday that I remember when my mom went to prison when I was a little girl. And I didn't know that my mom went to prison. I thought my mom just had left, because nobody really shared with me that my mom was in prison. I mean, can you imagine? 7 years old, 8 years old, mom in jail, don't know really what's going on with your dad because your dad's always at work. And they left me with my quote unquote stepmother. And the truth is, she treated me like she stepped on me. And I'll never forget being hungry, you know, stealing food to eat it in the bathroom. I'll never forget trying to figure out, why does it feel like my siblings are being treated better than I am being treated? I never really understood why step-parents, you know, treat children the way they treat children sometimes. That's why I don't like that step-mom, step-dad thing. If you have children and you're dating somebody, ain't no stepmama, ain't no stepdaddy. Those are your children, because you never know what you are doing to that child when you're calling them step, and the other kids, you know, are the kids. You feel stepped on, and she treated me like I was being stepped on. And I'll never forget that day. I'll never forget that day. I used to look out the window. We had a phone booth downstairs, and my room that I used to sleep in, you know, you could go to the window. And you could look downstairs, and I don't know why, to this very day, y'all, I don't know why, I used to always, always, always look out that window and look at that phone booth as if I knew that my mom was going to come get me one day. And if I knew that she was going to call me from that phone booth. And I'll never forget, one day I was sitting in the living room, and I don't really remember what happened. I had to be about 9 years old. I wasn't an adult yet. I'm only a little kid. I'm like 9 years old. So I really don't remember this, y'all. I'm 40 years old. And I heard an attitude. Okay, all right, I'm going to bring her. And she hung up the phone. And in my spirit, I felt like my mom was coming to get me. And she wasn't in the room that you could see downstairs. She wasn't in that room. And she was real mean to me. She was real nasty to me. And I was afraid of her. And I remember as a little kid, I didn't have Instagram. I didn't have Facebook. I didn't have no phone to call. All I had was this stepmom of mine's. And I go in the room. And she didn't tell me nothing. She didn't tell me nothing. I'm waiting on her to tell me my mom is outside. Get your stuff. Pack up your bags. It's time for you to go. She never said that. So I went to the window. And as I looked out the window, I can remember like it was yesterday. I saw my mom in a phone booth. And when I saw my mom in that phone booth, she said, "Your mom is downstairs. Your mom is downstairs." I just grabbed, put on my shoes. It was cold outside. I barely put on the jacket. And I went, and she didn't tell me to grab nothing or nothing. And I went downstairs, and my mom grabbed me, and she hugged me so big and held me so tight. And I'll never forget that day, because that was the day I felt like my mom came and got me, and she rescued me. And I'm sharing that with you all today, because as I sat in that house, and I looked around at all the people, as I looked around at all the stories, as I looked at Tammy Price, who, you know, was homeless. She was homeless, y'all, sleeping in her car with her kids. And now she's a millionaire. When I looked around in that house and I saw a boss lady, you know, a woman who, you know, raises kids. And, you know, at the time she was running her own businesses and dealing with stress and all kind of stuff, unhappy. And her skin was messed up. When I looked over and I saw her with her Christian Dior jacket on, I saw her writing. All I could think about was all the moments in my life. All the moments in my life as a child that developed, that made me develop these abandonment issues, that made me develop this resilience and this fight for really wanting to help see other people get free. Guys, at the end of the day, what is that thing on the inside of you that drives you to keep going no matter what? See, for me, I can't forget as a little girl, y'all, I'm 9 years old, as a little girl, hoping that somebody would come and get me. Can you imagine day after day after day having no food? And you're 9 years old and it's cold, you know, and being felt and treated like a stepchild. Can you understand how that feels? And as an adult, y'all heard the saying, what don't kill you make you stronger? So I didn't die. And so I had no choice but to develop a strength from that experience as a young girl. Where in your life have you allowed things to step on you and to press you down? Things that should have been motivating you and inspiring you to go harder. When are you going to get to the place that you say, I ain't nobody stepping on me no more? I'm not going to allow these experiences that are designed really to come and to develop me. How do y'all think you build resilience? How do you think you get strong? How do you think you get bold? How do you think you get tough? How do you think, you know, champions are made? You think it just things just come and it's given to you? No, it's the things that you experience as a kid that as an adult you start to use some of those powers that you develop from your childhood. See, I didn't know when I was 9 years old. And nobody came to get me. I was developing how to go out there and fight on my own inside. See, I couldn't fight and beat up my stepmom. I couldn't beat up my brothers and sisters for treating me bad. But I had to learn how to fight inside. I had to learn to pray and believe that God was going to send somebody to come and get me. I had to believe that no matter what's going on right now, and I didn't say it in these terms because I didn't know it in these terms. I didn't know how to think and how to speak to myself and say everything's always going to work out for me. Nobody taught me that. I wasn't trained. My mom didn't know that you could speak words to yourself and that thing happened. My mom didn't know the power of affirmations. My mom didn't know the power of a declaration. My mom didn't know the power of meditation. My mom didn't know about personal self-help and development. All my mom knew was how to sell drugs. And some of y'all are so blessed with so much opportunity and so much awareness. You got to pay attention. Every day, you got people The culture is elevating, y'all. I'm so proud of the culture. I didn't go to bed last night, y'all, till like 4 o'clock West Coast time. So literally, I'm on 2 hours break. I didn't go to bed till like 4 o'clock because I was blessed last night to hear Trenton, is it Sheldon, speak? I heard him speak. Let me see his name. I want to share this story with you guys. Because everybody has a story, y'all. Hold on. Trenton. His name is... I think his name is Trenton Shelton. I can't think of his name. But he spoke yesterday at the GoPro event here with Eric Worre. And when the event was over, Trent Shelton, yes. And when the event was over, my girl Jessie Lee says, you know, you want to meet Trent? And, you know, at this event that I'm at, for network marketers, you know, there's not black people, a lot of black people in my industry. It's not a lot of black people in my industry. It's not. And so when you hear a black person tell their story, and when you hear a black person speak, especially you guys that's watching here right now, we got to know that everybody who is successful, especially as a black person, they had to go through a fucking lot of shit to become successful. They had to go through a lot of shit to be successful. They had to go through a lot of a fight, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. They had to go through a lot. You know, before I get to Trenton Shelton, I got to tell y'all this story, too. So I'm 9 years old. Let me go back. I'm 9 years old. My mom picks me up finally for my dad. Hey, Jack. My mom picks me up finally for my dad. And I want y'all to know that she sent me with my dad. I mean, she sent me with my mom, and she didn't even pack me a bag. Can you imagine being a little girl trying to understand how are you moving to another state and you don't have a bag, you don't have a suitcase? Like, all of the things that I had acquired up until 9 years old was all gone, because when my mom came to get me, not only did this woman feel like these the things that she purchased for me while I was there was hers, okay? But she took my parts of who I was away from me as a little girl. And I didn't realize how, as an adult, I had, like, how can I call it? Abandonment issues. And not just abandonment issues relationally, but I had abandonment issues with my stuff. Like, I don't put that much value on stuff. You know how you buy a new pair of shoes and you busy trying to make sure that it don't get, you know, a little crease in it. You know, you're trying to make sure it don't get dirty. No, I will wear nice things, right? But I didn't care, because at 9 years old, everything I thought was of value to me was stripped from me. It was taken from me. So I didn't value the things. Like, some of y'all was able to have your own room, and y'all had y'all clothes, and y'all had y'all drawers and all of that stuff. And if you did move from one house to the next, you packed your stuff and took your stuff. No. This lady sent me downstairs with my mom, and she didn't give me anything. And so as a young girl, I started to not value nothing. And then as a young girl, when my mom would go in and out of prison. Understand, y'all, my mom and my dad was in and out of my life. My mom and dad was in and out of my life up until still right now. And so what is it that you need to develop inside of you from the things that you may still be battling with as an adult? What is it that you need to look at and eliminate that you may still be battling with as an adult? Y'all, I look at stuff and I'm grateful for the stuff, but nothing really matters to me. I don't get so excited. I got this Richard Mille watch. Y'all welcome me to the Richard Mille Club. And true story, I got a house on my wrist, okay? Little black girl with a 9th grade education, okay? Got a house on her wrist, and know that I like to do things that they say I can't do. Okay, so this Richard Mille is all right. I mean, I'm gonna be honest with y'all. To me, it's all right. It's my Rolex and my Cartier, you know, to me look better than this. However, it's not the look of this why I had to have it. It's the respect why I had to have it. It's the they don't think I can have it is why I had to have it. It's the elevation of the culture to make y'all understand that we could do, have, and be anything that we want if only we will believe. This morning, I want y'all to look at the things that can be possibly holding you back that you may not realize could be that childhood experience from when you was 9 years old. And you didn't realize that your mama was not leaving you. She was going to work. Maybe when you look at your dad never told you he loved you. Your dad never played basketball and football with you. Your dad never showed you how to tie a tie. Your dad never gave you that love that you wanted. Your dad was always chasing a woman or chasing a dollar. But what if you go back to your childhood or go back just inside of yourself and figure out what are the things that make me do the things that I do? Why do I go so hard? Or why do I go so soft? Some of y'all need to tighten up. Some of y'all lay down. So when I started to look at all of these things, I realized, what if your dad was never taught how to love? What if your dad never told you he loved you because nobody ever told him that he loved them, that they loved him? What if he didn't have a father to show him the way? What if he did not have a father to give him what you are desiring of him? Have you ever stopped and asked to hear the story? Have you ever stopped and asked your dad or your mama to tell you their story? Your mama not treating you the way you hope or desire, or your mom. I remember all my friends used to eat dinner at the dinner table. And I used to be in all that. Like, wow, I wish me and my family, you know, could eat dinner at the dinner table. And we never ate dinner at the dinner table. My mom died, and we never experienced being that family that ate around the dinner table. That's why one of the things that I love is when my family and I get together and we eat together around the table, because as a child, I never experienced that. I never experienced that. And I never had a chance to ask my mom. I never had a chance to ask my mom to tell me her story. Some of y'all parents are still alive. Some of y'all are dealing with childhood issues. You don't realize that what happened to you at 10 years old when you got molested. You don't realize that trauma that you have about men touching on you and the way you don't get too close to a man or to a woman, or you don't trust nobody, is because of what happened to you at 10 because you was touched as a little girl. You don't realize that the reason why you don't have no girlfriends is because as a little girl, that one little friend that had sex with your man, you know, and you never got over it. You never got over it. So as an adult, you grow up thinking all your friends gonna have sex with your man. Guys, let me tell you what y'all gotta do. A lot of us got this childhood trauma. As a child, I remember my mom bagging up drugs in front of me. Bagging up drugs. I was thinking about that yesterday. My childhood memory, one of my childhood memories, it's like you always seem to remember the bad stuff. I don't know why. Like when they're talking about you, they never tell the good stuff. They always want to tell the bad stuff. They never want to tell the people how great you are. They always want to tell the people how bad you are. But I remember as a child, the things my mom used to do. I remember watching my mom bag up drugs. And I'm talking about my mom sold pounds of weed. My dad sold pounds of weed. My mom sold big bricks of cocaine, okay? My mom trafficked her own drugs. I remember as a kid watching my mom wrap up her big bricks in a perm, and I remember how she did it. One of her plots and her schemes was to act like she was a beautician going through the airport. So she would have big old perm boxes and the big ones, and she'd have big old shampoos and conditioners, and she'd have the pack of rollers, and she'd have a cape, and she'd have on her cape, you know. My mom knew how to play the game. She was hustling. She trafficked her own drugs, you know, back and forth from Jamaica. And I remember as a little girl, while y'all was playing, you know, with y'all doll babies, while y'all was playing with y'all doll babies, and while y'all was going over y'all grandma's house, see, I never met my grandma. I never had a grandma. I don't know what it feels like to have a grandma. I never had a granddaddy. I don't know what it feels like to have a granddaddy. And so when y'all was playing with y'all little doll babies at night at 9, 10 years old, I'm praying my mama make it through that airport. I'm praying she get through that airport with her cocaine. I'm praying she make it through the airport. And so I'm telling y'all right now, some of y'all, my dad told me this and I'll never forget this, some of y'all are dealing with trauma from y'all mamas and y'all daddies. And y'all never once asked them to tell you their story. Mama, why did you do that? Why did you treat me like that? Tell me what you was like. What was it like in your household as a kid? You know, ask your daddy. Daddy, tell me, how was your family environment growing up as a kid? Your dad is the way he is because do you know what your dad been through? I want to encourage y'all today. To have some compassion for people. You never know what somebody is going through. You never know where somebody come from. You never know why people do the things that they do. And there's a lot of you all that if you would just have a little bit of compassion and a little bit of understanding for your family and ask them their story. You know, I said that earlier, God grant me serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. There is people close to you that they need to know that you care. And there are people that's close to you that hurt you and you can't get rid of them. God grant me serenity. You got to embrace them. You got to accept them. You know, I was telling my group the other day that I don't like this noise. You know, and I'm finna do it, y'all. I'm finna flick it. I don't like this noise. Whenever it's time for me to spoke, I normally like to pass it to somebody else. Because see, one of my childhood memories is that of my mom smoking crack in the bathroom beside me. See, many of you all don't know this, but when my mom did come home from prison, think about it, she was battling with PTSD. Come on, nowadays it's called PTSD. My mom didn't know about no PTSD. She knew that she was stressed out. And so what was her way out? Crack. And me and my mom had a room, and my mom's room was here, the bathroom was here, and my room was here. We had Jack and Jill bathrooms. And I remember as a little girl hearing this. When I heard that one time, I knew it was my mom smoking. When I heard it one time, I knew she was smoking. But when I heard this at about 10 years old, I knew my mom was on crack. Because I remember going under her bathroom cabinet one day. I was cleaning up. I wasn't looking for nothing. And I found this towel. And in this towel, I picked up the towel. And it was this pipe. And I saw a little white stuff in it. And I saw all of this other stuff. And a little fork. And I don't know what they need a fork for. What the fork for. And so I remember putting two and two together one day. And I kept hearing this. And I remember I put my mouth to the, I put my ear to the door to make sure I was hearing right. And I kept hearing. And I never forget, I put my mouth to the crack in the door. And I said, again? And then I heard the flick and it went away. The flicking went away. And my mom one day told me, She never said nothing to me. I was 10 years old. I couldn't tell my mom I knew she was on crack. That's rude. You talking to like that. When you get your ass beat talking to an adult like that. My mom told me one day before she died, I was blessed to get that story out of her. She told me that I stopped smoking crack that day. She told me one day that day she never said nothing to me. I didn't know she knew that I didn't even know she hurt me because I was afraid to say it. I was afraid, but I just, somewhere on the inside of me, I just built the courage because I loved her so much. And when I saw crack, when I heard flicking, I just saw death. That's all I saw. I didn't see just high for a minute. I just saw death. And one day she told me that that's why she quit. Because I told her and I embarrassed her. That's why a lot of y'all don't understand my leadership style. I've learned that there's such thing as tough love. You know, my dad, and I'm going to close out with this, told me the other day, I never forget the day. I'm about 11 years old. I go to the only man that I know. And I was taught that when you need something, you go to your mama and you go to your daddy. That's the first people you go to. They're here to protect you and they're here to provide for you. And I remember asking my dad one day because I wanted some candy from the candy store. I'm about 10 years old. And I asked my dad. I said, "Dad, can I have 25 cents? My dad looked at me and he said, "Earn it. Earn it." He didn't give it to me. And I remember saying, "Dad, it's 25 cents. He still didn't give it to me. And I remember at 10 years old, I said, Nobody would ever be able to tell me no ever again for 25 cents. And let me tell y'all something. That was when I started to develop the skills of you would never tell me no ever again. No man would ever make me feel like I gotta bend over backwards or kiss her ass or 25 cents. But guess what? It changed my life. It changed my life. If my daddy would have just gave me the 25 cents, I wouldn't have understood that things are supposed to be earned. But that's why I am who I am right now. And then my dad told me, and now today is a joke. And he always, always, always feels proud about that story because he knows that's when I became resilient and I decided nobody will ever make me feel like I gotta kiss your ass for 25 cents. No mama, no daddy, no nobody. And so I want to encourage y'all today to do two things. All of this for two things. I want to encourage y'all today to ask your parents their story. Actually, start with your mom and your daddy if they're alive. If not, may they rest in peace. Ask them their story. And if your mom or dad is not alive, it's good. I'm going somewhere, y'all. Find somebody that knows them and ask them to tell you their mama, your mama, or your daddy's story. See, you don't understand that a person may look away and you may be getting who that person is today. You may be getting that person's 40-year-old version of who they are. You may be getting that person's 25-year-old version of who they are. You may be getting that person's 22-year-old version of who they are. But have you ever stopped to find out why do you do the things that you do? Have you ever stopped to find out what makes you act like that? What makes you think like that? What makes you move like that? Or better yet, just ask them. Have enough concern to want to know their story. Find out why they don't flush the toilet. Like, I don't flush the toilet oftentimes, y'all. I got to give you a shameless testimony. Because I'm proud. Because I want you to know nobody's perfect. I am 40 years old, 40. And sometimes when I pee, I forget to flush the toilet, Miss Spade, Alana. And it could be embarrassing because I dated men that'd be like, "She nasty, flush the damn toilet," you know? But what they didn't know is, see, when I was a young girl, my water used to be off a lot. And when your water off, you can't flush the toilet. And so we learned as kids, because the water was off so much, only flush the toilet when you do number two. When you pee, don't flush it, because we don't want the stench of number two in the house. We can stand the stench of number one. And so at 40 years old, I'm still trying to eradicate and eliminate that part of me that thinks the water is off. I'm still at 40 years old, $1 million a month, a house on my wrist, baby. 3 amazing kids, 2 beautiful homes, Rolls Royces, everything you can think of, I got it. Millions of dollars in the bank. And I still think somewhere in here that the water is off. Work until they respect you. Work until you're able to tell your story. It's very therapeutic. It's very revelatory. It's very empowering when you get to tell your story. Me telling y'all this story this morning is giving me power. I'm going to give y'all one more and I'm done. I'm going to give y'all one more and I'm done. I'm 40 years old. My mom is deceased. I never had a chance to get my mama to tell me her story. I never got to understand why she did the things she did. And she is no longer here. She's dead. About a month ago. No, this was around DJ's party. I'm gone after this, y'all. This is going to change your life. This is gone. I'm gone. Don't go nowhere. I'm almost done. Around DJ's party time, one of my friends from school came over my house. And we was all downstairs laughing and joking. And my dad was down there. Light skin was downstairs. And light skin, y'all know light skin. Light skin is very quiet. Dark skin would talk your ear off, but light skin is very quiet. But light skin postured up. Dark skin talk a lot like me. And I'm a mixture of both of them, because I know when to stop and I know when to talk. And she's telling the stories about how my baby daddy, shouts out to Dre, y'all. Hennessy daddy home from prison, man. So grateful for him, man. He changed my life, too. All that time he would take shit back that he bought me. All them times he'll cheat on me with my friends and have sex with my friends. All them times he'll buy shit and come and take it back from me, you know? Yeah. All them times he'll punch me in my face and give me a black eye and stuff. Yeah. I appreciate you. He changed my life. Thank you, baby daddy. I'm not gonna tell y'all that story. No, I gotta tell y'all that story. And so she's telling my dad and all my friends, and she's reenacting my mom, and she's cussing, and she's acting just like my mom. Come on, let me go somewhere, y'all. And she says, we always wondered how did you date Miss Marlene? Because Miss Marlene, I have a big moat. Miss Marlene is gonna cuss your ass out. Miss Marlene, all of that. And we said, we never understood. And I was like, in my mind, saying, yeah, Dad, you so quiet. My mom ran over you. I know it. My dad looked at me that night when everybody left. The house was empty. It was just me and my dad in the living room. I'm in the kitchen. And my dad leaned over the thing. He said, you know something? Your mother wasn't always like that. He said, your mother wasn't always like that. He said, maternal instincts made your mom the woman she became. Your mom used to be very quiet and very sweet and very submissive. Your mom wasn't always like that. So I tell you this morning, know your mom and dad's story to get to understand you. I wasn't always like this, but my instincts to provide and to protect my kids from what I experienced is why I'm like this. I have to protect my kids from what I experienced. That's why I am who I am. Find out the story of your mama and your daddy. let people know who you are so they can have some understanding as to why you do what you do. Hennessy works out the way he does with y'all because, number one, he got shot and could have died running. He had to run for his life and jump over fences. That's the one. The second reason is that he feels responsible. His grandmother died fat and unhealthy, and he believes he could have saved her. So you got to know people's story because you want to be able to tap into that person and align with that person to get that strength and that energy from that person. And lastly, you do all of these things because they're going to respect you. You do all of these things because you want to have dignity. You do all of these things because you want to be the demonstration. You do all of these things because of your instincts, your maternal instincts, your desire to break the generational curse, your desire to not be another statistic, your desire to not be like them. I love my mama, but I don't want to end up like my mama. I love my dads, but I don't want to end up like my dads. And that is what has to drive you. Every day, it wakes you up out of bed. It wakes you up out of your sleep. I jumped up out of bed, y'all, at 6:04 to do this wake up and win call. I didn't go to bed till 4 o'clock this time because I was speaking to Trent Shelton. But I have no excuse. I got to get up and I got to deliver because y'all going to put some respect on my name. I will hear the voice of the Holy Spirit within. I will lead and not follow. I will create and not destroy. I am a force for good. I defy the odds. I set new standards. I am a force for good. Can y'all hear me? I said I am a force for good. I defy the odds. I set new standards. That's what I said. I am the head and not the tail. I am above and not beneath. I am the lender and not the borrower. I am loved by God. I am chosen by God. I am protected by God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And every tongue that rises up against me in judgment shall be condemned. It's my season. It's my season. Speak it. It's speaking over yourself. I'm just speaking it so you can catch it. It's my season. It's my turn. When you gonna make it your motherfucking season? That shit don't just come. This ain't like winter, spring, summer, fall. Yes, hardships are gonna come. Oh, but your season to prosper and your season to shine, it's gonna take your ass having to do something about it. It just ain't gonna happen. Ain't nobody just gonna give it to you. That ain't how this shit out here work. You gotta use your instincts. Your maternal instincts like my mom did. Y'all got kids to take care of. Y'all got parents to take care of. I would never be broke. I would never be broke another day in my life. I would never be broke another day in my life. And I will live the fullest of life in all God has for me. Y'all, today is a new day. Today is a new day. Get in alignment with what you want. Work out with Hennessy at 10 o'clock. Put on your workout gear. Meditate at 9 with us every morning. I got to still go on my meditation group. I got to. You know why? Because it's a part of my rituals. I've been meditating every day since October. I ain't stopping. And guess what? I'm going to still jump into the workout because I have to stay in the line. All right, y'all, I didn't mean to go this long. I don't even know how this happened. I don't know what was going on today, but I hope y'all got the message. I hope y'all got the message. I love y'all. I'm grateful for y'all. Thank you for trusting in me. Thank you for letting me speak my life, my truth, in order to help you to elevate. And I hope that these words and the things that I share with you guys in complete transparency helps you to become a better person. Guys, at 10 o'clock, my meditation group, y'all know we got to meditate. I hope I'm not the one on the schedule for Hennessy workout today. I hope I'm not the one, because if I am Hennessy, I love you, son, but I'm going to have to tap in with you later. Am I on this flyer for Hennessy workout? Because I hope I ain't. Let me see. Am I on this flyer for Hennessy workout? Please say no. I'm working out, but I ain't working out at 10. I got to go meditate, Hennessy. So I'm tapping in. I'm doing both classes. And y'all, let me tell y'all something. Can y'all go sign up for Hennessy Advanced Workout Class and stop being so cheap? The mere fact that he work out with y'all every day for real. The mere fact that he work out with y'all every day for free at 10 o'clock, you should almost feel obligated to want to give him $20, even if you don't do the damn class for real. I'm just saying, on some G shit, this boy work out every goddamn day with y'all. Some of y'all team is working out with him. Some of y'all working out with him. H-Fit at Vance at 11 o'clock. Well, yes, I'm doing that workout. It's $20. You know, sometimes I just send him $1,000. Sometimes I send him $250, whatever, because he's a hardworking man, and I want to tap into his principles, and I want to tap into his anointing, and I want to tap into his favor. So I throw him $100, or I throw him $250, or I throw him $1,000. He don't ask, but he work out every single day. He be on here. Man, this morning when I couldn't hardly wake up out of the bed, and I jumped up, I was imagining, Hennessy, I love you. I love you, man. I was imagining the days when he just tired. He just tired. But he got to get up and work out because he's committed to y'all. Come on, y'all. Drop some fire for my son real quick, man. Come on, y'all. Go to H-Fit Body Advance and join the class. I'm working out today at 11 o'clock with him. Y'all need to work out just on the strength that if he could do this every day, crazy every day, two times, three times a day, we could do it one damn time a day. So y'all tap in at 11 o'clock. Manai working out at 10. Meditation group. We're going to be a little late. Come on, let's go meditate. Let's do 5 minutes a day. I'm going straight to the meditation group. I'll see y'all at 10 o'clock. And then we're going to put on our clothes and we're going to work out. I love y'all, man. I'm gone. Bye-bye.